Is the brain a metaphor for the world? Hi, I'm Chris, I'm a doctor. Let me summarise a book for you. The Master and His Emissary, The Divided Brain, and the Making of the Western World by Iain McGilchrist. This starts outlining differences in cranial hemispheres, and it suggests that it's actually no longer a popular topic to researchers, as so many people are wrong. Even small differences between the hemispheres may lead to large shifts at a higher level over time. The left and right hemisphere of the brain compete with each other in a winner-takes-all fashion. If one hemisphere starts a task, it would prefer to finish it rather than utilize effort to switch to the other hemisphere. Even though such winner-takes-all effects may be individually small, over time there's a vast accumulation of many small effects that lead to huge biases. Especially if you repeat a performance and then one hemisphere tends to dominate and it becomes entrenched, so still it's a further advantage, which does really start off being quite marginal. It might then be that the division of the human brain is also the result of a need to bring to bear two incompatible types of attention of the world at the same time. One narrow, focused and directed by our needs, the other broad, open and directed towards whatever else is going on in the world apart from ourselves. In humans, just as in animals and birds, it turns out that each hemisphere attends to the world in a different way, and the ways are consistent. The right hemisphere underwrites breadth and flexibility of attention, whereas the left bears the focused attention. In general, the left hemisphere is more closely interconnected with itself and within regions of itself than the right hemisphere. This is all part of the close focus style, but it was also a reflection of the neural level of the essentially self-referring nature of the world of the left hemisphere. It deals with what it already knows, the world it has made for itself. By contrast, the right hemisphere has a greater degree of myelination, facilitating swift transfer of information from cortex to centres below the cortex and a greater connectivity in general. New stimuli lead to release of noradrenaline in the right hemisphere. Most neurons fatigue, that is to say they cease to respond when continuously stimulated. However, noradrenic neurons do not fatigue and maintain their condition of excitation so that exploratory attention is held open across a greater expanse of both space and time. The range of the right hemisphere is further increased by the fact that it has a longer working memory, and so it's able to access both more information and hold it together at one time for longer than the left. It's capable of bearing more information in mind and doing so over long periods with greater specificity, which also means it's less susceptible to degradation over time in memory. The left hemisphere, however, takes the short-term view, whereas the right hemisphere sees the bigger picture. There's the hierarchy of attention, and for a number of reasons, it implies there's a grounding role and an ultimately integrating role for the right hemisphere, with whatever the left hemisphere does at the detailed level needing to be founded on and then returned to the picture generated by the right. This is an instance of right-left-right progression, which is actually a theme mentioned throughout the book. The right hemisphere understands from indirect contextual information, clues, not only from explicit statements, whereas the left will identify by labels rather than the context. A good example for the left hemisphere would be that it identifies its winter because it's January, whereas the right may do so from looking outside and noticing the trees. The right hemisphere takes whatever is said in the entire context. It's specialised in pragmatics, the art of contextual understanding of meaning, and in using metaphor. It is the right hemisphere which processes the non-literal aspects of language. This is why the left is not good at understanding the higher level meaning of utterances such as "it's a bit hot today," whilst the right understands that may suggest "please open the window," the left assumes this is more of a helpful supply of meteorological data. Going back to some of the networks of neurons, there's actually more dopaminergic ones in the left hemisphere than the right. An excessive dopaminergic transmission, which occurs in many conditions such as amphetamine abuse, but it's also in high dose treatment for things like anti-Parkinson's drugs, can actually mimic aspects of schizophrenia, because it tends to favour the left hemisphere over the right. There's this asymmetry of hemispheric function in schizophrenia, with an abnormal but overreactive left hemisphere compared with the right. The passion for collecting and organisation and organising things is seen in many conditions, including Asperger's syndrome, a type of autism, and autism itself, which shows a right hemisphere defect. Ultimately, if the left hemisphere is the hemisphere of what, the right hemisphere is preoccupied with the context and the relational aspects of experiences, emotions, and the nuances of expressions, which could be said to say the hemisphere of how. Those more likely to have anomalous patterns of lateralization, such as people who are left-handers, those with dyslexia, schizophrenia, bipolar affective disorder, and autism, for example, together with their relatives who may advantageously carry some but not all of the genes for these conditions, are the least likely to show what might be called left hemisphere encapsulation. In other words, the normal brain, the serial processing that forms the basis of left hemisphere function, is carefully segregated from functions that it might impair. But the corollary of this is that the holistic approach of the right hemisphere is not available to the same extent for language and conceptual thought. In anomalous lateralization patterns, this segregation no longer occurs, with reciprocal advantages and disadvantages. So, did music or language come first? Well, this book suggests that music did, and that some animals communicate in musilanguage, the use of intonation, not just using body language to communicate with humans. Complex attack maneuvers of killer whales are interestingly also coordinated by what we may refer to as music, a language of pitch, intonation, and temporal relation. In a now famous experiment by Simon and Chabris, subjects were asked to watch a short video clip showing a basketball game in a relatively confined indoor setting. The link's here, you may want to pause it if you've not seen it before. They were asked to count how many times one team took possession of the ball and asked to count the number of passes from, say, white t-shirt to white t-shirt. Then, when asked afterwards, most observers were completely oblivious to the fact that there was a figure who came in a gorilla costume, walked across the middle, turned to face the camera, beat his chest a few times, and then nonchalantly strides off out of the video. And on second viewing, this appears blatant, as one knows what to expect, and it's very hard to believe that we've actually missed this in the first time. But these researchers have dramatically demonstrated that what we see, at least consciously, is only what we pay our focused, conscious left hemisphere attention to. and our incapacity to see what's most apparently obvious, the obvious features of the world around us, if they do not fit the template we're currently working with. This is part of what Noë and O'Regan dubbed the grand illusion, or our ability to observe what we expect to see, and it's so entrenched that it is hard to know how we ever came to experience anything truly new. The world of the left hemisphere is dependent on language and abstraction, and it yields clarity and power to manipulate things that are known, fixed, static, isolated, that are explicit, disembodied, and general, but ultimately lifeless. The right hemisphere, by contrast, leads a world of individual changing, evolving, interconnected, implicit, living beings within the context of the live world, but in the nature of things, never are quite graspable, because they're always imperfectly known. And to this world, what exists and the relationship of care. But one can see the generation of the greatest feats of human spirit actually require integration of both of these hemispheric worlds. Split brain patients do appear to have an impoverished level of imagination and creativity, suggesting that integrated function of both hemispheres is needed for such activity. The form that integration takes may be far from straightforward, of course. It may be that in the absence of the intact corpus callosum, it's impossible for either hemisphere to inhibit the other adequately and stop it from interfering for a critical period. Genetics are clearly important. The process that favours the gene for imitation gets started only if the crucial behaviour is partly imitable. If it's either wholly imitable, in which case the gene is irrelevant, or wholly inimitable, in which case the gene is ineffective, it won't get started. The behaviours in question have to exert sufficient selective pressures, that is, be sufficiently important to our survival. The process will work faster if the behaviours to be imitated exert greater selective pressures. Separation of the hemispheres brought with it advantages and disadvantages. It made possible a standing outside of the natural frame of reference, the common sense, everyday way in which we see the world. In doing so, it enabled us to build on that necessary distance from the world and from ourselves, achieved initially by the frontal lobes, which gave us insight into things that otherwise we could not have seen, even making it possible for us to form deeper, empathetic connections with one another and with the world at large. However, separation also sowed the seeds of left hemisphere isolationism, allowing left hemisphere to work unchecked. The view that romanticism is a manifestation of right hemisphere dominance in our way of looking at the world. The right hemisphere is more inclusive and can equally use what the left uses as well as its own preferred approach. Whereas the left hemisphere does not have this degree of flexibility or reciprocity. Whereas for the Enlightenment and for the workings of the logical left hemisphere, opposites result in battle, which must be won out by the truth. For the romantics and for the right hemisphere, it is coming together of opposites in a fruitful union that forms the basis not only of everything that we find beautiful, but of truth itself. So, I hope that you found that useful. Feel free to comment below, like, subscribe, and I shall see you next time.